Hit that subscribe button and bell icon so you never miss an update from Neela Bakore Tutorials. In this part, we'll talk about another group of plant kingdom, and that is Pteridophyta. The plants which are placed under Pteridophyta, they are called pteridophytes. They are non-flowering plants. That means the reproduction is not by seed or fruit formation. The reproduction is by spore formation. They normally grow in moist places, but there are pteridophytes which are found in sandy soil also, but most common is the moist place, and the reason as well as sandy region. The reason why they are found in the moist places is there is a requirement of water for fertilization. This is similar to what we find in bryophytes. The male gamete has to swim up to the female gamete to fuse with it. And the same thing happens here, and that is why there is little water required so that the male gamete can go and fertilize the egg. And that is why they are normally found in moist areas. We will also find that the gamete producing part, that is the gametophyte, is flat and it rests on the surface or on the soil so that it remains in contact with that thin layer of water. They are the first terrestrial plants, or we can say the first true terrestrial plants, and the reason why they are successful as terrestrial plants is they have vascular tissue, that is xylem and phloem. Now if you remember, bryophytes were called the amphibians of plant kingdom. Pteridophytes are known as the reptiles of plant kingdom. Now the reason why they are called reptiles of plant kingdom, because amongst animals, reptiles were the first true land animals, and they were able to survive outside water for most of the times. And same is the case with pteridophytes. They are the first true land plants, and the reason is they have conducting tissue, that is xylem and phloem. They also show the pteridophytes alternation of generation. There is a sporophyte stage which gives rise to the gametophyte stage, and the gametophyte again would give rise to the sporophyte. How this happens, that we will see in detail. Now let us talk about these two parts. The sporophyte, the two stages, that is the sporophyte and the gametophyte. The sporophyte is the dominant stage, and this is a very primitive, short-lived stage, not very conspicuous. So this is inconspicuous, not clearly visible. It's a small green thallus-like body, which we call the prothallus. The sporophyte is the spore-producing, and it is the diploid part. The gametophyte is the haploid stage. The sporophyte would produce the spores. Now these spores can be produced on the leaves, then in that case the leaf would be called the sporophyll. These sporophylls, they can be of two types. They can be very tiny leaves, then the plant will be called the microsporophyllus, or the leaves would be called the microsporophylls. The example here is Selaginella. And if the leaves are big, then they are called the macrophylls. And the plant will be called Macrophyllus, and here the example is of fern, where the leaves are pretty big. This is where the spores can be formed. In some cases, the spore-producing leaves, they get compactly arranged to form a structure which is known as a strobilus or a cone. So the structure where the spore can be produced is a strobilus, or they're called strobili, or we also call it a cone, where the leaves which are going to produce the spores, they get compactly arranged to form this structure, which is the cone. Here also, the example is Selaginella. In Selaginella, the leaves are tiny, it is a microphyllous plant, but the leaves are compactly arranged to form a cone-like structure. So this is how the sporophyte is going to be. So spore-producing structures could be the leaves, which could be smaller and large, or the leaves could be arranged in the form of a compact cone-like structure. The gametophyte is photosynthetic, green, heart-shaped structure, which is called prothallus. It is inconspicuous, but this is the gametophyte. And this is going to possess the male and the female sex organs, where the gamete formation would take place. Now, how exactly the life cycle takes place is that the sporophyte, which is diploid, produces spores. The spores are haploid, and here they're going to be meiosis. The spore germinates to form the haploid prothallus, and this prothallus is the gametophyte. This gametophyte is also haploid. The gametophyte produces the male gamete and the female gamete. These gametes, they fuse to form a 2N zygote, and this zygote gives rise to the sporophyte. The detailed structure will take up in the next couple of videos, but this is how the life cycle of pteridophyte is going to be completed. The predominant stage is the sporophyte stage. If you are able to recall, in bryophyte, the predominant stage was that plant-like structure which had two branches, a male branch and a female branch. That means this was the gametophyte. So in bryophytes, it is the gametophyte which is predominant. Whereas in case of pteridophyte, it is the sporophyte which is the predominant stage. Plus, in case of bryophytes, we saw that the sporophyte, that is the foot, seta and capsule part, remains attached to the female branch. That means the sporophyte was dependent on the gametophyte. Here, the sporophyte is completely independent. It grows on this prothallus, but very soon it becomes self-sufficient. It starts making its own food, starts absorbing its own water, minerals, everything. So this is how the pteridophyte's life cycle takes place. And we would talk about sporophyte and gametophyte also in detail. But the thing that we have to remember, that is, they are called the reptiles of the plant kingdom. And the reason is that they are the first true land plants. Now in the next video, we'll talk about the sporophyte, where exactly the spores are produced and how the structures work.